Hello and good evening, brothers and sisters. If you can hear me, give me a wave. Hey, wonderful to see so many faces from around Australia and New Zealand. If you are on the call last night, welcome, first of all, to those who are just joining us for the first time for tonight. It's night two of Renewing the Vision, the CHARIS retreat. And last night we had night one. My name is Patrick Keady, by the way. Should let you know who's speaking to you right now. I'm the moderator of Emmanuel Community up here in Brisbane, Queensland, and our borders will be opening soon. But tonight we're opening all our borders, aren't we, to the Holy Spirit. That's what tonight is all about, a night to open the borders of our hearts and our minds to Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. We've got a real wonderful night of worship and opening ahead, and really it's a two-way conversation. This is a journey tonight where the experience is how we enter into it. And I know we're all in living rooms and in different places around the country, in Australia and New Zealand. I was very pleased to have some visitors from New Zealand in our small group. I can see Barbara Hines waving to me there. Yeah, she was in our group last night. So it's wonderful. It's great to be reminded that we're family. The Holy Spirit connects us all as family, even though we're so widespread. And last night, Shane Bennett gave a rousing call to unity in the renewal. He said, toot, toot, the train is leaving the station, time to get on board. As one current of grace, with our wonderful diversity, but pouring into one river, it's one stream of grace, which is truly, there is only one river, and it's the river that makes glad the city of God, the Holy Spirit. Amen. So without any further ado, we're going to kick off the night with some worship. And I'm going to pass over to John Drucker and the Lifted worship team, who are ready to take us away and to lead us, lift our voices, lift our hearts to the Lord in praise and worship. So take it away, guys.
Okay, praise you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. It's so good to be here with you. We're Lifted. We're from Melbourne, and we're just going to praise the Lord. So let's go. Come on, let's sing and let's dance to the earth that goes the heavens. And let's pray that a sleeping world awakens, because there's a new day on the rise and the enemy is shaking as the graveyard springs alive. So let's pray. Let's pray for a new outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Jesus, how redemption, how salvation is in His blood. Jesus, light of heaven, friend forever, His kingdom come. We will sing and we will dance till the earth echoes the heavens. Sing His praise till we see the other side. 'Cause we belong to the light when the night is at its darkest. Just hold on, for the dawn will soon arise. Can you feel the winds are changing? There's a new day on the rise, and the atmosphere is breaking as a new world comes to life. And we will sing and we will dance till the earth echoes the heavens. Sing His praise till we see the other side. Whoa. There's a new day on the rise, and the atmosphere is breaking as a new world comes to life. And we will sing and we will dance till the earth echoes and heaven sings his praise till we see the other side. Whoa. Feeling the darkness won't last very long. I got a feeling the darkness won't last very long. I got a feeling the darkness won't last very long. I got a feeling the darkness won't last very long. I got a feeling the darkness won't last very long. I got a feeling the darkness won't last very long. Whoa, whoa. Graveyard springs to life. Let a sleeping world awaken. There's a new day on the rise. And the enemy is shaking as the graveyard springs to life. And we will sing and we will dance till the earth echoes the heaven. Sing his praise till we see the other side. Whoa. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. And we pray that the Holy Spirit comes now and fills our hearts. Come, Holy Spirit, let your fire fall. Come with your fire, Lord. Set my life on fire. Holy Spirit, come with your 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 fire. Come, Holy Spirit, let the fire fall. Fire fall, let Come, Holy Spirit, set my life on fire. Holy Spirit,
Holy Spirit,
set my life on fire. Holy Spirit,
Holy Spirit,
set my life on fire. Holy Spirit, set my life on fire. Holy Spirit, set my life on fire. Come, Holy Spirit, let the fire fall. Come, Holy Spirit, let the fire fall. 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 Holy Spirit.
Praise. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you for the fire of your Spirit. Thank you, Lord, that you release us. You release us in your Spirit. And thank you that we've never outgrown opportunities to be released in your Spirit. Amen. Tonight, we have a wonderful opportunity to step deeper into the river, to keep going with that river analogy that the Lord, there's a current of grace the Lord has. We're all like tributaries and we're all contributing. There's a lot of rainfall happening in Australia at the moment. And that could be a little bit of a prophetic sign. Bring on the rain. Let it rain. We're singing about fire. We're singing about rain. We'll do it all. But let's pray for the grace of the Holy Spirit to unite our hearts together and to knit our hearts together as one as we share in the same grace tonight. And tonight we're going to hear from a familiar. I hope you don't become too familiar because, you know, when you see, it's like furniture. You get used to seeing people around the renewal. There's people we all know, right? And we can take them for granted and we can think, oh, yeah, I know that guy or that person. Well, this person is, let's ask the Lord for fresh eyes tonight as we listen to our good friend, Father Ken Barker, speak tonight. He's going to speak about being renewed by the Holy Spirit. And him and the team over in Canberra, the Disciples of Jesus team, are going to lead us into worship. So let's just allow our brothers and sisters to take us on a journey. Allow, as Father Ken speaks, don't think of Father Ken, think of Jesus. What is Jesus speaking to you through our brothers and sisters who are going to lead us in this time of stepping deeper into the river? Let's go there together.
Thank you so much. It's great to be with you all. Yes, don't think of me. We turn to the Lord, huh? But this is the unique moment, I think, in the charismatic renewal in Australia. This is a unique moment. For the first time, I think, we are gathered with expressions of the renewal from every different quarter. We're gathered as one. This is enormously significant. Now, in the Psalm 133, it says, "How good and how pleasant it is when brothers and sisters dwell in unity." It's like the precious oil running down the beard of Aaron. Well, that expresses like it's a lavish gift. It's a wonderful gift. It's anointing from on high. For there the Lord commands his blessing. Life forever when we are together in unity. So that's the first thing that comes to mind, is that the blessing of the Lord is upon us mightily tonight, because we are doing something for the first time. Different expressions of renewal coming together to give glory to God, representatives from every different expression. What came to my mind actually was Marjorie Liddy. Auntie Marjorie, as we used to call her, she's gone to the Lord now. And Auntie Marjorie, an Indigenous lady from Melville Island, was a great friend of the renewal. She herself had experienced the baptism in the Spirit. And one night after she was coming back from fishing with her son, she experienced the whole light, whole sky lighting up. No longer was it dark, it was a light. And as she looked up, she saw a beautiful bird in the sky. And this bird, she said, was dotted with wings stretching from one side of the earth to the other. And it had a crown on its forehead, on its head. And she looked up and she said to her son, "Do you see what I'm seeing?" He said, "Yes, I see a bird." She said, "No, it's not a bird, it's the Holy Spirit." And as she said that, the crown burst open, the golden crown just burst open, and down fell all these sparkles, golden sparkles onto the earth. And she said she was still running to catch them as much as possible, so excited that she'd had this experience of the Spirit. And she began to sing a song that she grew up with many years before. Holy Spirit. That one. Yeah. Holy Spirit, fill this land. Reach out and touch us as you can. From the high, high mountains to the deep, deep valleys. Holy Spirit in this land. Beautiful song. It's a simple song. She sang it for us once at Light to the Nations, and it just moved. The Spirit moved right across the whole congregation. They're so beautiful. So Marjorie's prophetic sign, I think, means a lot to us. At World Youth Day in 2008, you remember, the theme was, you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And then you'll be my witnesses, not only in Jerusalem, but in Judea and Samaria until the ends of the earth. And so Marjorie had painted her vision of the big bird. So consequently, it was put up on the canopy over the Pope when he celebrated Mass at World Youth Day. It was on the vestments of all the priests. As a promise from God that the Holy Spirit is upon this land. And as we're representatives from all over Australia, we're really opening ourselves now to this gift of the Spirit. Because now is, I think, a Kairos time, and it's anointed and appointed time, really, to be expectant for a new outpouring of the Spirit. Now, at that first time when Catholics experienced this new outpouring back in 1967 in Pittsburgh, at the Dove, a place, that was a beautiful experience, of course. And Patty Gallagher Mansfield said that when she was, as a young woman, coming to that weekend, she wrote up on the board, "I want a miracle." And she was given her miracle because there was expectant faith. They'd read the Acts of the Apostles. They'd opened themselves to what God would do. And a beautiful thing happened as a result. The Spirit fell. And she found herself in the chapel, flat out on her face, just being soaked with the Spirit again and again and deeply. And then another one who was at that weekend, the first Duquesne weekend, was a guy named Dave Mangan. And he said, well, he knew that he'd been baptized and confirmed, and he'd been told that Jesus promised the power of the Holy Spirit. And the word in Greek for that power is dunamis, which we get dynamite from. So he found himself walking around the weekend saying, "Where's the dynamite? Where's the dynamite?" And of course, he got his dynamite as well. He too found himself flat on his face before Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament, anointed with the Spirit. So I think tonight, and through this new time with the Spirit, we're meant to find that miracle again in a new way, a deeper way, many miracles. That the Lord would actually work a miracle so that we who are feeble and weak and broken will become instruments to bring this baptism of the Spirit to the whole of the Catholic Church. Nothing less than a miracle, you know, for all Catholics to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, huh? And so the Church then really needs to come alive in a new way. And by this Spirit being poured out, that's what's going to happen. So let's really make ourselves available, huh? The other thing that I was thinking about, the image of a dove in the St. Peter's Basilica in Rome, that beautiful image that we know so well, right up at the back and over the high altar, and it's in the stained glass. And the dove, of course, speaks of the gentleness of the Spirit, But you might notice, if you look closely, that actually the dove has talons, it has claws. That, I think, speaks of the fact that the Holy Spirit comes to disrupt. The Holy Spirit comes to shake us a bit sometimes. And I think that's what Pope Francis is allowing the Spirit to do with us, to shake us up a bit from our complacency and our security, shaking us out of being our comfort zones so that we come into a new experience of the Spirit that I think the Lord wants to bring. The Pope Francis is warning us of the danger that Paul warned the Galatians of. You know, that what we began in the Spirit might end in the flesh. And so we need to allow ourselves to be shaken up in a new way by the Spirit and find a new purpose and a new vision for what God wants to do with us. So it's a listening again. It's a listening again with a new openness to the Lord. What is this new movement of the Spirit? How is the wind of the Spirit blowing in a new direction? So if we put up the sails and catch that wind of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit wants to bring increase. He wants us to widen our tents for a new influx of people needing healing and restoration. He wants us to be fully given to Him, not to sort of huddle in dedicated groups enjoying just the blessings that we get, but be given to His purpose for evangelization for the world, you know, to bring the blessings that we've received to others. Now we're to go to the lost, the broken, the lonely, those that are isolated, those that are poor and marginalized. And the Lord's pushing us out of our comfort zone into new ways of moving in the Spirit if we allow Him to do that. So I believe this is a new season of grace. He wants us to fan into a flame again, that gift that God gave us when hands were laid upon us, as Paul says. Much of what the Spirit is doing is really getting us to reclaim the power that's in the baptism of the Holy Spirit and make it available to the whole church. Now, we're stewards of a big grace that God's given. He's entrusted it to us, not to hold it to ourselves, but to really bring it out to others, to as many as possible. That's the big grace, and it's God's answer for the needs of our time. So under this grace, we don't go to tell people, you know, what they have to do to be saved. We rather go to tell people to announce their salvation has come in Jesus Christ through His death and His resurrection. The saving love of Jesus is what's needed most in the lives of every person, to feel the deepest question and cry in the heart of every person. So let's reclaim again this great experience of the baptism in the Holy Spirit, and let's make it available to as many as possible. It will revolutionize the Catholic Church if we let it happen. It already has done amazing work of renewal. But God is not finished with us yet. He's got a long way to go in what He wants to bring to us. So this new experience then of God's love poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. You know, it was great to hear the testimony of Raniero Cannibalesa. Now, he'd studied Christology, which is all about Jesus, from every angle, from all of his study in patrology, and he just knew it like the back of his hand. But he said, when I got to that Kansas City experience, and when I heard people singing, "Jesus is Lord," everything changed. He said, I began to realize that at that point, I knew about Jesus, but I didn't know Him in the depth that I needed to. And what a beautiful grace this is. And he said, look, the words of St. Paul, I believe that nothing can happen that will outweigh the supreme advantage of knowing Christ Jesus as my Lord. He said, for the first time, I understood it. For the first time it penetrated my heart. For the first time I knew Him as my Lord, saying from the depths of His being, Jesus is Lord. Now, remember in those early days as we sang Jesus is Lord, we really meant it. These days, I'm not sure how we mean it. And so we need to have a revision, as it were, inside ourselves, a revitalization to claim the truth of who Jesus is as Lord of our lives. As Paul says, if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved. That's the gift. So this gift of being baptized in the Holy Spirit brings personal transformation to our lives. You know, he's a sanctifying spirit. And so to open our lives again, to bring to us a new infilling of the Spirit so that there's a change that takes place. Because I think what happens in our spiritual lives is we settle. We become quite complacent and we've done enough. You know, it's sort of like, that's enough inside of me. Rather that the Lord has a whole new agenda for us if we allow him to do that deeper work in us that he wants to do, to transform us personally. So that we really experience him as the one who gives us a new creation, you know, a new life in him. So there's a change that takes place, you know. I remember the change in my first experience of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. There were so many changes, but one that was very significant was I had a sort of a pattern in my life, in my thinking, that was sort of not working for me at all. It was working against me. It was a terrible pattern that was sort of tearing me down. And I had to really ask the Lord, the Spirit, to show me how Jesus has died for me, and he can break that power in my life that's already been applied to my life in my baptism and my confirmation. And huge difference. It just evaporated by the power of God. When the Spirit starts to do this transforming work in us, and you know, he melts the frozen heart, he warms the chill, you know, he works on the stubbornness of our wills and helps us to really come into a new place of surrender. So let's open ourselves to the Spirit and the personal transforming work that he wants to do in us. And he'll bestow charismatic gifts in a new way. The new evangelization has really only just begun. And the Spirit is, at this moment, releasing charismatic gifts in the lives of so many people around the globe. And we need to be part of that. We live in this privileged time of the Spirit, and the gifts are being recognized and expected in normal Christian living. It's no longer just these big, high-flying people who are using the gifts of the Spirit, but anybody who opens their heart will experience this great gift. You know, the gifts of prophecy and healing and deliverance, powerful manifestation of the word proclaimed. That'll really sort of give power to our words and power to our witness. It's a beautiful thing. You know, Damien Stain from London tells that beautiful story of when he was out with a number of young people, you know, evangelizing in London. And they saw a man near a railway station there who was, you know, he was crippled. Obviously, he was in a wheelchair. So they went up to him and sort of said, look, do you think we could pray with you? He said, I'm not a Catholic. I'm not a Christian. So that's okay. Would you still like us to pray with you? So he gave in. He said, yeah, okay. So they started praying with him. And as they were praying with him, he started to manifest. And he's screaming and screeching, and obviously there were some demons coming out. And so people around, because there was a big crowd, got a bit sort of disturbed by this, and they rang the police. And so the police arrived, you know. But by that time, the man was out of the wheelchair, and he was praising the Lord. And the police, what happened here? What's happening? Well, I'm free, I'm free. The Lord's come, set me free. And so he went with them and continued preaching the good news. So that's the sort of stuff we read about in the Gospels, and that's what we will find in our days here now if we allow it to happen, if we allow the Spirit to release us in his gifts in a powerful way. That's what he wants to do. Because he wants to break through that secular mentality, that the gifts become a convincing sign that shows people that the gospel is alive, it's real, it's not just sort of make-believe. Because I've seen it with my very eyes, it's become visible to me in the change that's taken place in people's lives before my very eyes. So we pray for the Spirit to come upon us as a new Pentecost, huh? To give us a new fire to evangelize. I remember that African bishop at one of the synods not that long ago, and he was speaking to all the other bishops. And he says, you know, when Peter stood up after Pentecost, he gave one preaching and there were 3,000 converted. But when we stand up, we give 3,000 preachings and nobody's converted. What's the difference? He said, the Holy Spirit. We need the power of the Holy Spirit for the proclamation of the gospel. You know, I had this image today of spot fires. I wasn't quite sure what to talk about fire, because sometimes that can feel very destructive to people who've had some destructive fire experience. But it's also this used in the scripture so strongly for the Holy Spirit. We just prayed for it, didn't we? Set our lives on fire. So come, Holy Spirit. So it's for spot fires all over Australia. I think the Lord is actually lighting these fires, igniting the fires. And he wants us to be in touch with that, because he said, I've come to bring fire to the earth, and I wish it were blazing already. Now, Pentecost, of course, was the experience of fire. Holy Spirit came down in tongues of fire and rested over all of them. And they were all filled with Spirit. They began to prophesy and pray in tongues and give glory to God. So that's, I think, what the Lord wants to do. We're waiting here, gathered all over Australia. We need to open ourselves to the new fire of the Holy Spirit to come upon us. Not to think that it's going to be like it was last time. It's something new. And I think what the Lord wants most of all is he wants a new humility of heart, a new sense of our spiritual poverty, that we don't have God worked out, as it turns out. There are no experts in the Holy Spirit. There are no high flyers. There are no professionals in the Spirit. I remember in those early days of the renewal, we used to repeat often, not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. Not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. So there's a new call to surrender to the Spirit's work, rather than to think somehow or other in a semi-conscious way that we've got it all worked out, that we know what happens next, but rather the Spirit is a spirit of surprises. And so we need to be open to the surprises of the Holy Spirit. He is doing a new thing, and Pope Francis is helping us with this. So to surrender ourselves in a new way to his work in our lives. You know, I tell a story which some of you may have heard before, I suppose, but I can't help but tell it here. Pope John the 23rd, he was a roly-poly sort of pope, and he smiled and always cracking jokes of peasant background. And anyway, in those days, the Pope rarely left the Vatican. But he decided he'd go leave the Vatican and go to the Hospital of the Holy Spirit to visit the people there. And so the Hospital of the Holy Spirit was run by the Sisters of the Holy Spirit. So the Pope arrives, and they're all in the flap. And so the superior of the sisters, she comes out and she says, oh, Holy Father, I am the superior of the Holy Spirit. And he said, oh, you've got one up on me. I'm only the vicar of Christ. Huh? So the point is, we're not the Holy Spirit of the Holy Spirit. Huh? We're not the superior of the Holy Spirit. Huh? We want to be under the guidance of the Spirit. We want to be led by the Spirit. Go where the Spirit takes us. Led and guided by him. So we need to acknowledge our own incapacity, that all the planning, all the strategies are quite useless if they're not coming from the Holy Spirit. We need maybe to repent of our presumption, our self-sufficiency, our pride. We need to avoid all that routinizing of the Spirit. We turn up, this is how we do it, this is what happens, that's how it is. You know, where we've institutionalized things so much, that's why the Pope is disrupting us. That's why he's destabilizing us. Is that the right word, destabilizing us? That's what he's doing, you know, to actually free us up a little bit so we're not sort of in the same mode as we were before. So God forbid that we could domesticate the Holy Spirit. I'm sure we couldn't do that, but we could maybe think we're in that vein. So it's a time to really come to a deeper place in ourselves where we realize that we can't do it. When Tom Forrest was preaching many years ago at St. Joseph's College in Sydney, I was there as a young priest, sort of not really sure of what this charismatic renewal was all about. But he had this pitch. It was very simple. He said, you've got to be able to say three words. I can not. And I knew at that stage as a young priest that that was right. So I tried a number of things and that all failed. And I knew I couldn't do it. I knew there was an uphill battle in the ministry. How do we sort of put some fire into the church? You know, because the people that I was working with at that time, I guess they were God's chosen people, as we were told in theology, but in fact, they're more like God's frozen people. And how do you defrost the church? And so it was that sort of thing of how do we defrost the church? And so that's when in discovering the baptism in the Spirit, because Tom said, look, there's one more word you've got to be able to say. Yes. Yes, Lord, you can. I can't do it, but yes, Lord, you can. And I'd suggest tonight, that's what we need to do. We need to humbly acknowledge that no, we haven't lost our way, but we need the Spirit more to take us into a new level of response to God, and a new commitment and a new vision for what He wants for us. And we need to acknowledge that we're in need and to cry out to Him from the depth of our hearts. You see, and what I did on that occasion and what I'm suggesting we do tonight, so as Tom suggested, to unite my yes to the Lord with that of the Blessed Virgin Mary. You know, when she was faced with the impossible, and I look at the renewal today in Australia, we are faced with the impossible. Well, so were Peter and James and John and all those and the first Pentecost. They were faced with the impossible too. And when the Blessed Virgin Mary was faced with the impossible, she said to the angel, look, it can't be. I don't know man. And the angel said to her, he didn't say this part, but he's more or less saying, don't worry, it'll be done for you, huh? He says, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and you'll be overshadowed with power from on high. That's how it's going to happen. And so she simply said, yes, let it be done to me according to your will. Now I'd say, in our deep need at this time, as we look around at the Catholic Church in Australia, the sleeping giant that needs the kiss of the Spirit like nothing else, and when we look around, how do we revitalize the church? How do we fulfill the purpose that God has given to us? How do we bring the baptism of the Spirit to all of our brothers and sisters? How do we aid the Catholic Church to really become an instrument of evangelization in today's world? How do we meet our contemporaries in a way that they'll be able to see that Jesus is Lord? How do we meet the deepest needs in those that are suffering and isolated and separated from the church, don't know where to go? How are we going to do this? How are we going to set up communities where we can invite people into the life of the church in such a way that they experience Jesus and they learn to love Jesus? They don't just come into an institutional reality, they don't just come into a fast food place, but they come into a body of people who are alive in the Spirit. How does this happen? How can it be? You see, we want this miracle. We cry out for this miracle, Lord. We want you to do a new thing with your church, and we will be your humble instruments. But we're weak, we're broken, we don't have much to offer. We're here for you, Lord, we're available. So, Lord, we can't do it, but yes, Lord, you can do it. Come, Holy Spirit, fill us afresh. Work on us first, and then work on our communities. Work on those who don't even know you, Lord. We know, Lord, that you'll go ahead of us if we pray and place ourselves available. You will. If we intercede, Lord, you'll go ahead. You'll break into stubborn hearts and you'll melt frozen hearts, Lord. You'll give a new life. We wait on you, Lord. We call upon you. Come, Holy Spirit, do a new work with us. Glorify Jesus. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He comes to glorify Jesus. And in our lives, many of you will be able to say, yes, he's come into my heart to glorify Jesus within me. He's come into my heart so I know Jesus. I'm in love with Jesus. He's the Lord of my life. So the Holy Spirit will do a further work in us to glorify Jesus in others because of the ministry that we'll bring to them, because of the words that we'll speak, because of the gifts of the Spirit that we'll exercise in such a way that they'll think, he's real, he's alive. Yeah, the Lord is calling us at this time to be set free from all our limitations, all those thinking, those things that keep us in bondage to what happened yesterday, rather than waiting upon what God is doing now and what he wants to do in the future and take us forward in. So let's be set free from all those presumptions. Let us be set free from all of our thinking patterns that set us in the particular grooves that sort of keep us down in imprisoned in our own thing. Let's have our hearts opened up by the acknowledgement with real humility, we can't do it. We can't do it. You see, I've become a professional charismatic. God forbid. It's a terrible thing to be a professional charismatic. I renounce it. Not the charismatic part. Although we don't call ourselves charismatics as such, huh? Because that seems as if we've got all the charism, nobody else has got the charisms. No, we call ourselves as brothers and sisters renewed in the Spirit, who want to bring this gift of the Spirit and the charisms that we've experienced to many others, huh? That's what we call ourselves. We're alive in the Spirit people who want others to become fully alive in the Spirit as well. And we want the charisms to be distributed widely within the life of the church. That's God's purpose, surely. It's written into the Vatican Council documents in chapter 12. That the Catholic Church is not just an institutional church. It's not just a sacramental church. It's a charismatic church. We're all charismatic. That's what it is to be a Catholic. But people don't realize it. And so we have the great opportunity, my brothers and sisters, to humbly let the rest know that you too are gifted through your baptism. You too can be released in power by the Spirit. You too can come alive to know Jesus personally, not just an historical figure back there. So this is the gift that God wants to bring us, the gift of this new evangelization, the new Spirit that he pour out upon us. So let's pray, huh? Let's ask the Lord. In Luke 11, it says, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be opened to you. Now what father amongst you, if the child asked for bread, would give him a stone? Or if he asked for fish, would give him a snake? Or if he asked for an egg, would give him a scorpion? If you who are so evil know how to give good things to your children, how much more will your Heavenly Father give you the Holy Spirit if you ask him? So let's do it. Let's ask for the Spirit. Let's ask for the Spirit to renew us and then revitalize us. Give us that new vigor that we most need at this time. Let us surrender to the Spirit. So I invite us now to sort of enter into worship. It's when we worship the Lord, and with that attitude of, I can't do it, Lord. I'm lost in all this, but you can. You'll show us the way. You'll give us the new path. You'll give us the new vision. You'll give us the new hope. You'll give us the new strength. You'll give us, Lord, the new vigor and the energy. You'll give us the vision that we need, the vitalization that we need. Come, Holy Spirit, huh? So let's worship. I ask to Tim, thank you, Tim, to come and help. And the brothers to worship. So let's just enter into this time of worship. This is Tim Kirk and the brothers there, Gonza and Wentz. Let them take us away in worshiping the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father Ken. Jesus is alive. Those brothers and sisters with me here, let's stand. Maybe wherever you are. If you can, if you're not on a train or on a bus, stand. Let's just put ourselves consciously, intentionally in the presence of Jesus. As Father Ken has declared, he has been raised from the dead. He has been raised from the dead. He has been raised within his church. He is alive. His church is alive. The Spirit is still being poured out just as he was back at that Feast of Pentecost in the upper room in Jerusalem. He's still being poured out. Jesus, who loves us so much, has received from the Father the gift of the Spirit, and he's pouring it out on the church still right now, on you, right now. We're going to worship him, and as we worship, let your heart go free. Just let the doors of your heart open wide. And I know that some of us have been in this movement, Charismatic Renewal, for so long. Well, it's a new beginning tonight. As Shane declared last night, as Ken's declared tonight, this is a moment of grace for us. It's a moment of grace for the church. Receive it. Receive the power of Jesus. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing that can compare. You're our living.
Your presence, Lord.
I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Spirit.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come from this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Nothing worth more. There's nothing worth more that can ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place. Your glory. Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come from this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord.
So, Lord, we repent. As we are in your presence, we come before you, weeping for the sins of our disunity, Lord. In the past, we have been competitive. In the past, Lord, we've maybe been prideful against one another. In the past, maybe we've made harsh judgments. In the past, Lord, maybe we've done things and said things that we really regret now. But we come before you and we repent. We ask you forgiveness, Lord, for all the sins of the renewal in Australia over the years. Oh, Lord, in those first times when people rushed off to communities and they saw that that was like the answer and everybody else was second rate, Lord. We stand against that now, renounce that sin that was there, Lord. And those times, Lord, where people have just pulled away, Lord, out of anger or bitterness or contempt for others, Lord, we know that you make us one. And come, Holy Spirit, make us one. We repent deeply of any disunity that we've caused in the past. But now, Lord, our heart is to be one in you, one with one another. Thank you, Lord. Come, Holy Spirit. You thank you, Spirit, who is the unity between the Father and the Son from all eternity. Holy Spirit, fill us and make us one. Holy Spirit, we love you, Lord. Come, Spirit of the living God, fall on us now. Thank you, Lord. Holy One, mighty God. And we surrender. Together we surrender with one voice and one heart, with one mind and one spirit. Together we surrender. Together we say, Lord, we have maybe botched up at times. Maybe we've made a mess of things at times, Lord, but you have not given up on us. But now we turn back to you with all our hearts, Lord. We turn back to you as one and we acknowledge you as Lord. You are Lord truly. And we call you, Lord, to come upon us in a fresh way. Invigorate us in a new way, Lord. Empower us and strengthen us. We surrender to you. Come, Holy Spirit.
All these pieces broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole, empty. empty-handed, but not forsaken. I've been set free. I've been set free. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saves a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. I can see you now. Oh, I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down.
Thank you.
To life, and we know that he loves to heal broken hearts, broken minds, and broken bodies. So if you have a need tonight in this time of great unity and love and celebration of the grace of charismatic renewal in this country and beyond, if you have a need, just like blind Bartimaeus, Jesus will say to you, what do you want me to do for you? What do you want Jesus to do for you tonight? This is a moment of great faith and unity, and when brothers and sisters are gathered in unity, great power is released. What do you want Jesus to do? As I was praying before, I had the sense that some people here have got some issues, like women, I think, particularly, some struggles as a consequence of giving birth to children years ago. Some issues around incontinence. Jesus loves you just where you are, and he's reaching out to heal you now. Thank you, Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. I had the feeling of someone who felt when walking to them was like you had a chain around your legs. There's a real heaviness, a heaviness in your pelvis and in your legs. So walking is painful for you. Well, get up where you are right now and start to move your legs. Jesus is touching and healing you now. Of Jesus, we come against cancer in any body of any person who's watching our Zoom broadcast tonight. If there's any cancer anywhere in your body, we rebuke it now in the name of Jesus. Anyone with congenital heart disease, we hold you up before our beloved Lord Jesus, and we declare healing in your life tonight. Healing from constant heart murmur in Jesus' name.
I just had a sense of someone who has a really deep and depressed spirit, an anguish, a deep anguish of heart. That's there, been there for quite some time, and the Lord is just ministering his peace to you at this time. Just receive his peace. He says, peace I leave you, my own peace I give to you. Do not let your heart be troubled or afraid. Jesus will meet you right now in that moment of your deepest anguish and bring you the consolation that only he can bring. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Let's continue just in surrender to the Lord, just in yielding our lives to him. We want him to really just meet us in a new way. And he can only do that if we give him permission, if we say yes to him in a deeper way, just to surrender and, Lord, I'm yours. I belong to you. Lord, my life is very short. I know I'm going to you in eternity. Lord, I want my life now to be according to your purpose and your will. Lord, I offer myself to you. Lord, here I am. I come to do your will. I surrender to you, Lord. Reveal your heart to me. Open my heart, Lord, more deeply, Lord. Grant to me the graces that you want to give to me at this time in my life to be able to move forward. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Glory to you, God. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father Ken. Let's sing one more song. Really open our hearts now. Let's recommit ourselves. As Father Ken often says, that he'd had a long journey as a priest, and he was actually, he doesn't talk about it, but he was a very successful academic within the church as well. But at a certain point, Father Ken's journey, he decided to put his life completely under the grace of the renewal. I just feel that maybe we could do that again tonight as we sing this last song. We really believe, all of us watching, I'm sure, that the Lord wants to rekindle the fire of the early days of the renewal, maybe in new ways, in new creative expressions, but there's a fire that he wants to enkindle in our hearts, that the grace of the renewal would flow with great power through the church, as Father Ken was saying, to renew the church and to evangelize the world. So as we sing this song, Eagle's Wings, let's put our lives, rededicate our lives once again, as Father Ken was preaching, under the grace of the renewal, the power of his Spirit poured out from heaven.
Here I am waiting, abide in me, I pray. Here I am, Lord. Me in your love, bring me to my knees. May I know Jesus more and more. Come I will rise.
So we thank you, Lord, for this beautiful moment. We give it all to you. We thank the brothers for Tim and the brothers for their ministry to us tonight. Thank you, Lord, that you touch our hearts. We trust you, Lord, with our lives. Bless his name.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, guys. That was beautiful. So beautiful to be led into worship and for us to push past the barrier of a screen or a room or the fact that some of us are not surrounded by people around us to push past those physical COVID barriers. But look, we're united in worship with each other, brothers and sisters, around the country, around across countries. What a beautiful gift. And so let's keep that spirit of worship alive. Let's keep that going. Let's take that into our night when we wake up tomorrow and we go into our prayer. Let's not just leave it as, oh, well, tick, we did that. That was great. Tomorrow morning, let's continue through this weekend to keep that spirit of worship alive and asking the Lord, what do you want to do to us? What do you want to say to us? I'm going to invite the Lord to speak to us through three of our members of the renewal around the country, and just going to pass over to them. I'll let you know who they are, and then I'll hand over, and we can just hear some reflections on three different topics now, just as a way of responding and to what the Spirit is saying and what He's moving and what he's speaking through different people. We're going to hear from Ashan De Souza first, from the Risen Lord community in Brisbane. That's wonderful. And then we're going to hear from our sister Anne Brereton. God bless you, Anne. We love you. And she's going to be speaking about looking to the future. And finally, we're going to hear from Matt Humphreys in Sydney, who's going to speak to us about outreach to youth. But first, let's just pass over to Ashan. He's going to speak to us now about being transformed in Christ. Take it away, Ashan.
All my life, I was searching for something. I was searching for meaning. I was searching for love. From my small days, I felt I wasn't loved much for my family and people around me. And as I grew up, I wanted to fill this emptiness. I got addicted to alcohol, marijuana, went out a lot of partying, a lot of nightclubs, got into fights, been in hospital a few times, and I basically lived a reckless life, a selfish life. It was all about me, myself, and how to satisfy my desires. I was wasting away all my money. And many years back, I got this, I was diagnosed with this sickness that doctors couldn't figure out what it was. I went from one hospital to another, went from one specialist to another. I took so many MRI scans, CT scans, but no one could really figure out what was wrong with me. And when I realized that no one in this world can help me with this sickness, I fell into severe depression. I really thought my life was going to end very soon. And it was during these darkest times that, by the greatest coincidence, I ended up walking into this retreat called the Four Steps Retreat that was organized by the Risen Lord community. I actually went there to meet one of my old friends that I haven't met for a long time. Probably went there for like 1 hour or two and to come back. But when I went and sat in there, I heard the word of God like I've never heard before. It was as if someone was directly speaking into my heart. And, I had tears in my eyes at times. And somehow I decided to stay for the entire retreat. And at the end of the retreat, they were praying over people. And I went to the front to get prayed over. And I remember people were just praying over me. And it was just like a current that was going through my whole body. And, I lost control of my entire body and I fell to the ground. That's all I remember. And I don't know how long it was. I woke up all of a sudden. And when I woke up, I realized things were different. It was as if a lifetime of weight was taken off my body. I felt so light, felt so peaceful. There was so a joy that I've never enjoyed in had in my life ever before. And you know, I wanted to just scream and shout that with the change that was taking place. And that was the first time that I experienced the power of the Holy Spirit in my life. You know, love of God just you know, came into my heart. You know, I received forgiveness from God. You know, I received healing. From that day, things started to change in my life. You know, one by one, my addictions were broken completely. You know, I started to grow in love with the Lord, you know, with scripture, and you know, my selfishness was going away. You know, I started thinking of other people. You know, I started to love other people like God loved me, and things started to change. And you know, it was 6 years ago to date. I remember that moment. It was the best moment in my entire life. And all I want now is to do the will of God in my life. And I thank and praise Lord Jesus Christ for saving me. And you know, even if that's what I have to do for the rest of my life, I will praise His name forever. God bless you all.
Hello, my name is Anne Brereton, and over 35 years ago, my life was transformed through the power of the Holy Spirit. My testimony is one of how God calls the very ordinary and uses them to build His kingdom. We hear some amazing testimonies of how people have had an extraordinary encounter with God, and they are changed instantly. That is not my story. In fact, I remember very clearly the first time I was prayed with for the release of the Holy Spirit. I said to a friend of mine, I felt absolutely nothing, so that didn't work. And I can honestly say that many times over the years since then, I've had a further release of the Holy Spirit, and very rarely do I feel anything. Yet looking back, I can see how the Lord transforms me each time I receive this powerful and simple prayer. I was raised a Catholic and grew up and still live in a small country town in Tasmania. I loved God but saw Him as a strict father sitting in heaven watching me and keeping count of everything I did wrong. When I was around 17, I was sitting in a church and I looked up at the crucifix. It was during Lent. And I said, Jesus, what was it like to die on the cross? Immediately, I felt really sick and I became very scared. And I got up and I ran out of the church. But the thought that came to me was, He heard me. He actually heard me. And for the first time, I realized that God wasn't somebody up there in the sky, but He was in here. And He heard my every prayer and my every word. Some years later, my mother invited me to attend a prayer meeting. I wasn't impressed with all this hand-waving and the kissing at the end, but I persevered. Eventually, the Lord invited me to the leadership of the prayer group, and after some time to serving Him as the chairperson of the Australian National Service Committee for around about 12 years. During that time, I also represented the countries of Oceania on the international committee called ICRIS. Many times I would shake my head in awe that the Lord had called me to serve Him in this way. The Lord has given me many opportunities to travel the world, sharing His love and building His kingdom. I've met the Pope, prayed with cardinals, shared meals with famous figures of the worldwide Charismatic Renewal. The Lord inspired me and the Holy Spirit transformed me through meeting these brothers and sisters. Yet it's the connections I've made with the simple people He has put in my path which have impacted me the most. Like with the man we met in the banana fields of Uganda, incredibly poor, living in a mud hut, yet he was so excited when we visited him. I clearly remember he came out of his hut and invited us to sit on some homemade stools. They were small and each had three legs, none of them the same length. Before allowing me to sit, he took off his hat to wipe the dust from the stool. I've sat on ornate chairs, I've sat in the front rows of many conferences, nothing compared to the beauty of that stool in the presence of this humble man. Jesus was present. It really was heaven on earth. The Holy Spirit has transformed me through decisions I've made of which I'm ashamed. Walking past a homeless man one night, I felt prompted by the Holy Spirit to give him a donation. I didn't have any change, so decided to have my meal first and give him some money on my way back. He had left, of course, and immediately I was convicted by the Holy Spirit. I was also transformed. God gave me a new heart for the poor and the homeless. No longer do I wait until later, but I stop to give and also to connect with them by asking their name and a bit about their life. Traveling so much, the Lord gave me an unusual ministry, which I call the toilet ministry. It happened that whenever I was in an airport toilet, the cleaner would be there cleaning the toilets. I would stop, connect with them, and simply say, "Thank you for serving us." 99% of the time, their face would light up through this simple word of gratitude. Isn't that what Jesus would do? Notice those who are so ordinary and are often so invisible. I'll finish with one last story. Over 30 years ago, I was in a store with a couple of my sons, and they wanted to ride what was a mechanical horse. You'd put money in and you would get a two-minute ride. I didn't have any change, and the boys were sad. But then a lady came up and offered to pay for them. It would probably be about 50 cents in today's money. She showed me the kindness of God, and I still remember her today and pray for her 30 years later. A random stranger doing a kind act and reflecting the image of God. This testimony is about the future. You are that future. Connect with the people you meet in your daily life. Use the gifts God has given to you. Live your ordinary life, inspired by the Holy Spirit, where every simple act has the capacity to influence and transform others. Indeed, you may have somebody remember that random act of kindness and pray for you 30 years later. Each moment of each day is your opportunity to build the kingdom of God here on earth. The future of the renewal is in your hands.
Hey everyone, my name's Matt Humphreys from Sydney, Australia, and I'm going to be sharing with you a little bit about outreaching to our youth, particularly as the renewal. A little bit about me and my background. I was raised in a Catholic family, but actually had a baptism in the Spirit experience in a Pentecostal church. And it was soon after that I felt a really strong calling to come back to the Catholic Church, especially be involved in areas of youth ministry. And it was soon after that I encountered and discovered the Catholic Charismatic Renewal, alive and strong and well. And I got involved in a lot of music and also a lot of youth ministry in a whole lot of different areas, whether it be from my local youth group to national programs with the CCR, as well as things wider in the Archdiocese and camps and talking at schools and all sorts of things working with youth. All in all, it's been over 20 years of working with young people and our Catholic faith. One thing I'd love to touch on today is that young people are disinterested in faith, that they find it boring and not relevant, and it just doesn't have anything to do with their lives. And while a lot of young people may say these kind of things, deep down I've discovered that I've never met a young person who isn't hungry for spirituality, that there's this part of them that's really interested in the spiritual side of things, even if they can't articulate it themselves. And you see this a lot in their attraction to things such as palm reading or horoscopes or yoga and all these sort of things which have this spiritual element attracts them. And so deep down, everyone, including our young people, has this desire that there's something more and there's something spiritual in our lives. And I think that's a real gift that we can offer them as a charismatic renewal. I'd love to share with you a story that really points out this truth. I was once invited to come be part of a wider Archdiocese camp. Now, this wasn't a camp run by the renewal in any sorts. In fact, I was the only really charismatic leaning person on the team. And when we were planning, we planned a Holy Spirit night. And then the team somehow, without me pushing or without me even suggesting, decided that they'd like to try this prayer teams thing at our camp. And then I got volunteered, knowing my backgrounds, to organize some people to come and pray for these young people on the Holy Spirit night. Now, I was partly excited because I thought, this is great. Young people get a chance to experience the Holy Spirit and come and be prayed for in this special way. But I was also a little nervous because I knew that I was the only one with a charismatic background and people weren't familiar with a lot of the things that might go on in a Holy Spirit night. And so as we planned the camp, I organized a whole lot of people I knew who were familiar with praying for people to come and pray with these young people over two nights. So the first night was for them to make a commitment to Christ. And I remember there was about 50 young people, and I remember preparing the prayer teams and saying, guys, this isn't a charismatic event. We sort of had an agreement that we'd pray softly for them. If you were going to pray in tongues, that keep it under your breath, underneath the music, and just pray really gently with these young people who have no experience of the renewal. And the young people were all interested in this new thing of being prayed for, and they all lined up and they came. And on that first night, they had a very peaceful night. You know, a lot of them made a commitment and a beautiful commitment to Christ, and they received some prayer and they came out saying, oh, that was really calming. I felt really at peace and I felt a bit more at ease. And so the second night I gave the same briefing to the prayer teams, but this night the Holy Spirit had a different agenda to us. And so as these young people came up for prayer again, but the kids, however, were hit by the Holy Spirit. And before long, as I'm watching around the room and these prayer teams happening, you saw a lot of the things that you might expect on a real charismatic event. People sort of falling over and resting in the Spirit, people breaking out in tongues, and the gifts of joy was right around the room. And to be honest, it was probably one of the most tangible presences of the Holy Spirit I felt in a group context like that. It was off the hook, you might say, as a young person. And I remember the next day, after talking with the team leaders and sort of explaining to them as best I could what was happening, we had a session, and an impromptu session. And in that session, I spoke to the young people and said, okay, guys, last night was pretty different, right? Let's talk about some of the things that were happening. And the kids had so many questions and they were so excited and hungry about what was happening. And then my favorite part was I gave a chance for the kids to come up and share. Now, they started up and coming sharing about sort of the things that happened to them, but that quickly transformed into sharing about how it changed them and how they felt peace and how they felt love and how they felt on fire for God. And it was so exciting to see. So one of my big learnings from this event is that sometimes we try to hold back the Holy Spirit side of things and we try to be careful and gentle in how we introduce it. But I find young people are so hungry for this side of our faith. They're so hungry for an encounter, a spiritual encounter. And we can offer that as a renewal to them, an encounter with God, a healthy spiritual encounter. Jesus gave us this beautiful gift of the Holy Spirit. And I believe it's our job as a renewal to be upfront and clear and transparent about its beauty, about its goodness, and not to shy away about presenting it in that way. We've been given this gift that's not just for us, it's for the whole church. And there's thousands and thousands of young people who are hungry, waiting to discover this beautiful gift of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you so much. That was beautiful, Ashan, Anne, and Matt. So good to be encouraged, isn't it, by the word of testimony, which encourages us and builds our faith and reminds us just what the Holy Spirit can do if we give the Holy Spirit room and power in our lives, in our church. Ashan, I loved that story about his healing from addiction, and it's almost like his heart was defrosted. Father Ken earlier was talking about being destabilized, but being defrosted and asking, how can we defrost the church? And it's the Holy Spirit who defrosts the church. But Ashan's testimony was like the Holy Spirit defrosted his heart and bathed him in God's love. That was beautiful, Ashan. And I loved hearing your testimony about how you've gone on a journey of God is actually listening to you and speaking back. That's a great surprise to all of us. And I love that toilet cleaner ministry. Maybe many more of us will be inspired to take up toilet cleaning ministry next time we go to a public place. Let's look out for the cleaner and let's tell them that they're really appreciated and that God loves them. Imagine that. And Matt, I can absolutely attest. Yes, young people are hungry for the spiritual. Absolutely. They're so open. And that's one of the things I love about ministry with young people is that they had far few barriers up. So what a great encouragement. Thanks guys, for sharing with us. Before we close, we just bring things to a close now. I'll share, there was a word that came through. Father Brian Steele shared a few words of knowledge there. But yeah, there was a scripture that came to his heart and he shared it with me earlier. And it's a good way of closing was this theme of awakening. And what God has done with us in these last two nights is he's reawakened us. Reminded of that scripture in Genesis 28, 16, where Jacob woke from a sleep. And it's like the Lord is saying, I am waking you, my people, from your sleep. I am waking you from your stupor. The Lord is awakening us to see each other. He's awakening us to rub the sleep from our eyes and see the unity in the body of Christ, to see the unity in the renewal, to see the beauty of the diversity in each other. The Lord is awakening us. Let's rub the sleep from our eyes. Let's awaken to a new day, brothers and sisters. This is not the end. The renewal, as it closes towards these 50 years, is not, well, that was a nice period of time. Maybe it'll fade off into the distance. No, the renewal is just getting fired up. Come on. Are you with me? The renewal is just warming up. The Holy Spirit is just warming up. It's our job to keep in step with the Spirit as he warms up his church and warms us up. I love that concept of, as Steve Kirk and the brothers were leading us in worship, there was a sense of hunger for the Spirit being reawakened in some of us tonight. Have you been reawakened tonight for a hunger for prayer, for a hunger for repentance? I love that Father Ken came and led us in prayer and said, Lord, we repent. I haven't said, Lord, I repent for ages. That was great. It was so refreshing. What a refreshing word. Lord, I repent. Lord, restore our hunger. And this concept of this, he's gathering the broken pieces. One of the worship songs spoke about all these pieces broken and scattered and being gathered together. Truly, that's what the Lord wants to do with us and is doing with us, even now, even now. So let's close in just a short time of prayer, thanking God for what he's done, gathering us together, speaking to us through his body, through our brothers and sisters tonight and over the last night as well. Lord, we pray, come, Holy Spirit, awaken your church. Kiss us on the forehead, just like when we're waking one of our children who are asleep, we give them a kiss on the forehead and we wake them gently. Lord, a slight tap on the cheek and a kiss on the forehead. Lord, bend down, wake us from our slumber if we've been sleeping too long. Lord, awaken us to the reality of each other. Open our eyes to see the beauty and the diversity in the renewal, in your church, and in the body of Christ around the world. Lord, awaken us to a new mission, to a new era of mission. Awaken us to the mission on which you have for your church. And Lord, we beg, we plead, we pray that we would be at the forefront of it. Use us, Lord. Unite us together. Use us. We make ourselves available for your mission tonight, Lord Jesus. Here in Australia, we pray for this land, the great South Land of the Holy Spirit. Lord, set us apart. Set the church apart to be a source of healing for the nations, that the leaves bring healing, that we would be the ones who pluck the leaves of healing off the trees on the side of the river of grace and feed our nation. Lord, help us to be at the forefront of the healing of our nation and the renewal of this land. Father, we thank you for softening our hearts and the warmth and fire of your love, defrosting our sometimes cold hearts. We thank you for loving us that much. And take us forward from here, Father, we pray. Continue us, help us to continue to journey with one another as we renew our faith and as we renew our vision, the vision which you give us, as you open our eyes to see the vision you have for us as the renewal in this country. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a great night, everyone. It's been wonderful to spend this time with you. God bless.
alive. The empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. Are mine.